We're getting into like my juicy favorite spot now. Okay, we did all the preliminary stuff. Now we're going to actually talk about like the interview. And I'm going a little long on this, so I'm going to start really talking fast. Okay, so I want to talk about preparing for the interview, and this is when you've got to recruit and do all of these good things now, right? So you've got this job, this description that you're going to grab from your job description and your critical analysis and that type of thing. And I promised that there would be a little section in here about social media recruiting. And when I started writing it, I realized that that was like a 40-hour workshop. So what I'm doing is I'm giving you a couple of quick tips on this. And then if you are into getting more, I actually have like about 34 pages of an ebook that I can send you. It's from some of my HR resources. So I'll forward things to you if you're interested in it. But I really thought it was important to talk about it as an important means of recruiting these days. And that includes the online job boards that we're traditionally used to. How do you recruit? You do newspaper still? Yeah? What's your best recruiting source?
Front Porch Forum.
Isn't that great? Okay. More tips. What else is working for people?
Indeed.com.
Yes.
What is it? Indeed?
Indeed. I-N-D-E.
Do you post directly on Indeed?
Only certain positions, the state will do that, and they you can do it a couple of ways where you can pay for hits, or you can pay, my understanding, you can pay a monthly fee or whatever it is, but nursing positions are difficult to recruit for, so the state pays for Indeed.com, and they do it based on hits.
Let me tell you about what Indeed is. Indeed is a compiler site, and what is super nice about Indeed is that it pulls job listings from all sorts of websites and puts it all in there so that if you're a job searcher, it's very convenient because I can go into Indeed and I can get most of the jobs posted right there. So my tip, if you don't have this great stipend like she's got, is you're gonna post your job on something that you know goes to Indeed but is as low or free posting as you can get, and I think things like jobs in US and jobs in Vermont is in it, jobs in, yeah, that kind of thing. So post it on the lower end sites, it'll get pulled automatically into Indeed, and that's she's got it, that's the way to go with it. So you can pick specific sites to post on. If it's an IT position, there's some Dice and things like that are really good.
It's interesting, I have it on Indeed and Craigslist by far.
I was going to say.
I'm so surprised at that, but that's by far.
And that's what everybody says, because it.
Craigslist.
That's right. Don't go buy in a car. Don't go to a cab. But it does. People always say the same thing. Craigslist, believe it or not, Craigslist, because it's free and it really can be effective. What do you think?
I've had a really bad experience with Craigslist in that every time I post on there, I'll get this flood of amazing resumes, and then I start trying to call these people, and they're all just applying for unemployment. They
yes.
don't actually want the job. They just send a resume for unemployment.
So let me flip the scales for you here and start talking about social media recruiting. How many of you are using Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter for recruiting? Are you getting some results? Okay. What I want you to think of is that it is a process. It doesn't happen overnight. And the real way you want to do it is you want to start building relationships, not just when you've got the gig to post, but you want to start following the right groups. So there's library associations or whatever. Start following them. And that way you could post to those sites. If you can friend people. So I have over 600 links. So I'm always amazed when how many people I can connect up with. But that's what I would be doing. So if there's an IT position, look at what kind of affinity groups are out there for you to eavesdrop in, start commenting on. To me, that's social media recruiting. It's not just paying for the job posting on LinkedIn or Facebook. okay? They'd be happy to do that. But it's really about forming these relationships before you need somebody, okay? So get them excited about your company. Start building some connections in there. If you have employees, which you do, they're on Facebook, they're on LinkedIn. Have them, especially on Facebook, say, hey, there's a job opening at the town, and this is what it is. Look at all the nice connections that you can start going out to. So I think those are some of the things that I would start first. John, what would you do?
The LADC has like JobSlip and Job available to any employer who wants to know it's free.
Ah. LACD?
LADC.
Spectacular, right? Okay, so there's lots of resources. Any other great tips to share right now?
Good food jobs.
They are.
So, what should I say? Good food jobs, if you're related to food. Right?
So there are specific sites. You can really do a web search on recruiting sites for IT, for food, for that type of thing. And see if there's any that come up that you might want to follow and see what's going on. Yeah. So that's the real way to do it. So the first thing is start where the people are. Find your affinity groups, right? And think about how do I start making these connections before I need it. You plant your garden before you harvest it. And it starts in your office. Don't forget to make sure your employees, friends, family are spreading the word for you. That's awesome. Get recommendations. If you're on LinkedIn, you know, not those, just those simple recommendations, Whitney's great at this or whatever it is, but get customers to say something about your company. Put that on Facebook. Those are recruiting tools because now I'm an applicant. I'm looking at your company and it's like, nice. Now I can have a much smaller ad in the newspaper, point them to, for more information, look at our website, look at these other resources that we find. But here's the thing. About 85% of jobs are found through networking. All right? The online, the advertisements in the newspaper is about the rest of it. So if you think about it, it's social networking. It's not just, hey, Suzanne, who do you know that might be interested? Social networking is great. Now, we've got some discriminatory challenges, because if you network only with people that look like you, then you are building a company that might look just like you, and that's not bringing in any diversity, which is not good for the company's health and growth and that type of thing. So add that to it, and that's why social media can be very healthy in that way, because it can broaden your audience and see, you know, who you link up with. Makes sense? Good start? So I have information on how to build the strategy step by step and do an analysis. Don't go doing it until you know what your goal is, because if you're haphazard, it won't do much for you. Charlie.
Yeah, another spot, which is gone because we do have a student here from Johnson State College. I've had a lot of clients lately, if they are specific to a industry, if there's a state college or a college near you called the Career Department, and they always have a list of alumni and a lot of times they will post jobs on the alumni website.
There you go. So join the group. So you can join the group and get right into that. And those are free things.
And then, yeah, there are no costs. And then generally, the career services is happy to take them to put on the alumni website.
Right. Absolutely. Networking is all about that. So that's a good start for you to just start thinking about how to get into it now versus now I have a position and it's kind of hard for me to do it. All right, so now you've done your recruiting, you've got your applicants all from Craigslist, and they're all, I had to apply for 5 jobs this week, so thank you, because you made it so easy for them. So that's that. And then you want to be able to screen those resumes. And it can be laborious, right? People love to do that. I remember at Dartmouth, we had some people that would just apply for every single position, just like all of them, and finally said, you just really got to stop because like your chances are not good by doing that. So you really want to make sure that their application has something to do with the job relevancy, right? So I'm on page 13. You don't make assumptions. Remember, 85% of resumes are prepared by somebody else. Gasp. Become resume writers when you're part-time, right? Look for red flags. That's date gaps, right? You know, where were they? Which institution were they in? Or what, you know, who were they raising? That type of thing, besides H-E-double-L. Vague phrases, you know, the type of thing as monitored, watched. It's like, so there's all those kinds of words. It's like, they actually do it, or they're just going to watch you do your work. That was good. I monitored that all day long. So we've got to be careful with that. Sort your resumes by ABC. So that's what I would do, is I'd get my 60 applications. And here, these look good, BCs. And then out of the A's, I would decide how many of them I want to do a phone screen on. And I always do a phone screen. Do you all do a phone screen? Excuse me. As of tomorrow, do you always do a phone screen? Yes. I thought so. I thought you all do. I knew it. Clairvoyant. So you're all going to do a phone screen. There's lots of reasons for it. It's going to save you time. Because if it's not, have you ever started an interview and a few minutes into it, you're going, how long do I have to do this to be polite? Right? Yeah. Let's not do that. Okay? Because that's wasting your time and the applicant's time. So we don't want to do that. We want to screen them over the phone. If they've got to talk to your customers, don't you want to hear how they are? I've been on a phone screen where I've actually heard the person scream at their kids, "Shut up, I'm on the phone." Aw. Yeah, that was unfortunate. So I just want to know, I want to know these things before it's with my customer. I want my eardrum to recover on its own. So I'm going to screen it. Do it that way. Look for my competencies. Which ones look? Make sure it's a focused resume versus one that they blanketed out to everybody. Okay. So I'm just kind of skipping over page 14 because you can just read that. I've got this pre-screen questionnaire. Now you're going to make up your own questions, but here's the kind of thinking that I put into doing a pre-screen questionnaire. I would call and say, is this a good time to speak? Or set up time by email. I like the element of surprise because I'm a warm person like that. It's like, I'm going to do a gotcha. Okay, so I've got that. I'm going to do a pre-screen by calling. Is this a good time to speak? And if you're the applicant, I hope somebody would say, yeah, not really, right? And make a time. So that's okay to do. And I want to know, so tell me why you're applying for this position. Why, what attracted you to the position? Why did you apply for this position? So I've actually had people say to me, what company is this? I tell them. They go, what position was this? All right. So, my time is being saved pretty quickly there, right? Because I wanted them to be really excited when they heard my name. So, fine. That's why I asked that question. It's like, make sure, how present-minded are they, and are they ready to engage with me? Tell me why you're in the market for a new position. Always a rich conversation. How'd you hear about the position? Why do I want to do that?
To learn what's working.
Yeah, I want to know what's my best recruiting sources, right? Or if it's an employee, if I have any kind of employee, I want to thank a co-worker for sending somebody, if you hire them, not before that. What salary are you expecting to earn? Now, everyone hates this question. Wouldn't you hate this if somebody asked you this question? But I want to know it. I'm really, this day and age, I'm not into playing games and being coy. I have set salary structure, whether they tell me or not, and I let them know. I know I'm stressing you out, basically. But Listen, it's not going to impact my salary range, but I'd like to know what you're expecting, because if they're looking seriously for 85 and I'm paying 25, I know I've got a gap, and I know everybody is going to inflate it. So if they really want 45, they're going to say 55 because they think that I'm going to give it to them that way. So I just ask them what range they say, and if they say something, whatever they say, I'm going, what are you basing that on? I'm very curious, and they're going to let you know. It's like, well, because that's what I'd like, because that's what I'm earning now. But get, you know, give me some ballpark, and they go, and then I would tell them as a career coach, you don't answer that, and I would tell them how not to answer that, but I like to ask it. say, well, you know, compensation isn't my only priority, and I'm confident that you've done your due diligence. So that if this is a good match for both of us, I'm sure that salary won't be in the way. Okay? And that would be yes, a few people. right? Or I would just have them say, I'm looking for your most competitive offer. But first, it depends on total comp package and your benefits and yada, yada, and if you're going to make my dinner. So, you know, I would just coach them to try to say something like that. There's some old rules that say the first one that says a number loses. That's old thinking. I tell you, you know, you're hiring millennials, you're hiring the Gen Xers and whatnot, and they're not into all of this, the game playing that, you know, they want to know. That's what I'm reading about. That's what I'm experiencing, is that it's a much more straightforward.
I got to tell you, on the other side of that, getting the advertising phase, I've really struggled with it, because I used to put the salary range, and then you get people that were expecting too much money because that was the range.
Yes.
And you didn't want to be limited by that range, because frankly, if someone was really that good, I didn't want to be boxed in by it. So I've started to say salary depending on qualifications. I mean, the downside of it, though, is you want to let someone know we're a serious player, we're a progressive company, we're willing to pay, it might pull someone in. But, you know, in the end, I moved towards more of a range, you know, or like 70s or 80s, but now I've just started saying depending on qualifications. And I don't know if that's helping or hurting, but I didn't like feeling like I was boxed in.
Yes, right. And plus, if you say it pays 9 to 12, they're all going to be thinking, I'm worth 12.
Right.
Right? And, you know, they pay in the middle range. I actually like your approach.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like that. You know, competitive versus commensurate. That's absolutely right. And I don't think that would screen people in or out. You know, in that way, you kind of leave yourself open. And I'm sure you've got salary bands that you have to... You know, that you have to play with. But that way, if you're doing the pre-screen and you have someone asking them, what are you looking for, you would at least see if they're within that category. And what are you basing it on, and is there flexibility in that? And then you'd know that's either an A pile, I'm going to proceed, or B pile, there's some questions here, or C pile, they screamed at their kids. Or kicked the dog. John.
Just as an interesting aside, the difference between cultures. I ran a company in England for 7 years. And in England, if you change a job, you've been working for X company and you take, you leave and you go to work for another company, the old company sends your new company a slip that tells them how much money they were being paid. So you can't lie about how much money you were being paid in your old job, because your new employer is going to get a document telling you exactly how much you've been paid. The other thing that's interesting, too, is if you look at the ads over there for employment, they'll say male, 25 to 35. They will say no one under 50 need apply. They will say, and they will give exact salary ranges in almost all the ads.
That's right, and that's why we say God bless America. Land that I love. Yeah, and that's why we have a robust employment law thing. Yeah, because we have these protections. Like I said, the first thing, it protects both of you. So, yes.
Just to offer a little perspective on the flip side, because I just went through a very lengthy search for my current position.
Yes.
And I was looking for a higher level management position. position, and I found it somewhat frustrating when the salary wasn't in there, at least in a range, because I knew I had a level that I had to have because of what I was used to.
Mm-hmm.
So I was looking to know that. And if it didn't stop me from putting my resume in. I did send it in. But that was the first question, or one of the first questions I would ask when I did get the call, you know, the pre-screening phone mm-hmm. call. What are you offering for yourself?
You see, people don't want to be coy these days. They really don't want to be. So more, I'm seeing a lot of companies just ask straight out on their application process, what was your salary, what's your salary history, what's your expectations, and it's just making it harder for us career coaches to sidestep this stuff. But, you know, it is. It's basically you want to just, let's have an honest dialogue. That's what we're trying to get at. So thank you. Why do you think you're qualified for this position? That's interesting. What experience do you have to support that? So I'm going to ask some clarifying questions. How soon are you looking to make a transition? Please describe three practical skills that you possess which make you a qualified applicant for this position. I didn't ask for the, what are you best at? You know, skills that apply to this position. I want, you know what I'm trying to do? I'm trying to get a sense of how do they envision this job? But it's giving me a lot of good information. First of all, have I advertised it accurately, right? If they think I'm looking for Cinderella and I'm really looking for the chambermaid, that's not going to really, you know, help. What do you think?
Well, it's mentioned here gaps, you know, gaps in employment and so on and so forth. One of my, and perhaps I'm old-fashioned, you know, I look at resumes and if they're 1-2 years at all these jobs, you know, I don't want to invest all this time in someone who's been, but I hear that that's
old-fashioned.
The world these days.
It is. Absolutely. In fact, the high-tech companies would see that as a downfall if you're someplace 5 years. They would say, well, you're just not staying. Right.
Yeah.
So it really depends.
5 years?
Yeah, you know, for a high-tech job, you know, for something like that, you want to see a consistent salary progression and a responsibility progression. So I'm not so concerned about that because, hey, if somebody's a superstar and you don't have all these career ladders for them, and they keep getting recruited away because they're so rockin', why wouldn't I want to be inviting them? So that's why in this pre-screen I'd be saying, so, you know, tell me, it seems like you last 2 years, and it's say because, you know, somehow my supervisors kept disappearing mysteriously. That's one piece of information, you know, versus, yeah, I was recruited away, and then I did this, and I did that, and I had to relocate because of a spouse or partner, something like that. So I would not use that as a screen out. I would use that as, let's find out more. Yes?
Is there anything that you would change about this questionnaire if it were a part-time position?
No. You could ask them. You see, you can add whatever you want. Yeah, what kind, you know, what, so what hours are you expecting to work, that type of thing? Yeah. Is there, you know, what is the range of hours you're expecting to work? I'd ask stuff like that and let them know this is a part-time position. That's 15 hours. How many hours do you want to work? 15. Right, you know, so you ask them a range of what they'd like to work. But yeah, add questions that make sense to you. I'm just kind of giving you some general tasty tidbits here. And then give them, you know, any red flags, like I see these gaps, opportunities to have them ask some questions to see if they've really done any research on you. I'm always amazed, aren't you? How many say, so what do you know about our company? And they go, not too much. That's not...
And in this day and age, with everything being on the
web, oh my God. It is so easy these days, yeah. So it doesn't show a lot of genuine interest in your company. It shows I'm filling in the box. Yeah, so that's why it's so helpful, and you'll get a tone of their voice, and especially when they don't know it's you and they answer the phone, hello, right? And unless they've had a cold like me, you know, it's you're just looking for how they sound and what their demeanor is. Okay. I got to go rocking in here now. So I'm going to let you, I'm going to kind of move through these effective questioning techniques super quick, okay? Remember, I'll talk to you another time afterwards if you have a lot of specific questions. So just know that you can ask about past behavior interview techniques. I get the situation, and that's why I love behavioral or competency-based interviews. And I want to know, tell me about a time when you had to do this for that. What was the outcome? What was the nature of what you did? Who did you work with? That type of thing. That's going to get you, did they really do it? What was their role within that? You had to work on teams. What did you really have to do? A structured role play. That's really good. I actually went through one a couple of times, and they're really interesting. You know, I had to do, well, how would you approach this person or that person or whatnot? And then they came in and they played these roles with me. It was challenging. So you could build something like that. You might have them, like I would have them do a reference check. Let's role play a reference check. I'll be on the other line, do a reference check, and I'm going to say, we don't give that information. And see how they can get anything out of me. What do you do?
Computer skill knowledge is really important.
I would.
I mean, we ask a self-assessment type question, but I'm wondering now, can you just say, show me, do such and such?
You, whatever you do for one, you have to do for everybody, right? Fair and square. So if I screen everybody that way, then I can, and you have to make sure you're doing something that's a non-biased type of thing. So there are lots of bona fide ways of doing that would be perfectly okay to do it. Again, you do the same thing for everybody, or you wait until after a certain point and then my second tier interview. By the way, your accuracy by doing a second interview improves by about 50%. Right, so it's definitely worth doing a second interview. So I would certainly do that if they have to do something manual dexterity. Have them do a, I used to have little boards and whatnot that they had to do. And it's a great way.
You're screening your ability to ascertain whether it's the right fit and their skill set improves by 50% by inviting them back a second time.
Yes. Yep. Yep. Absolutely. So it's a really good, because it's that first impression bias kind of goes away, right? And you've now met other people. And, you know, there's lots of, is it better to be the first one, the last one, right? Orange hair, whatever it might be, that, you know, what's going to make me be the candidate of choice? So that's a great way of getting them back in and reconfirming. It's an expensive, I gave you the little hiring turnover calculation. You can figure it out for yourself. You don't want to make a mistake. So it's worth that investment in time. I would tend to do, personally, I would have staff members involved in the first interview, and I would do a cursory interview. And then the second one would be kind of with me. So it just depends, like as the town manager, how you'd like to structure that. But I'd want to meet everybody. And then you don't want people passing in the hall going, that was great, right? Because that's the bias, right? So you want to, no talking about this until afterwards. You'll fill out a little evaluation form, and then we will sit down and recap together. I'm very strategic about interviewing, but it makes it easy and replicable. Okay, so the probing, the open-ended questions, not yes and no. It's like really getting them to go deeper. And then let's go into the interview skills on page 18. Look for visual clues. Listen for patterns of behavior from one place to the other. Tell me about what you liked best about each of your former last three positions. See if there's a pattern in there, and why did you leave each position? And that there will answer all your concerns about gaps, right? What made you leave that position? So that'll answer that. And if they tend to not, well, I left because the supervisor and I, right? You're starting to see a pattern there. And what's the best predictor of future behavior? the mantra, right? So you want to figure that stuff out. And for you to take notes, I'd like you to take notes. Here's the rule. Do not take notes on their resume or application, right? You know why? There you go. It's part of their personnel file, and they could have access to that. So you're going to have a little, your questionnaire, you're going to just have that separately, and you're going to take notes on that. And not verbatim, take the pertinent notes, right? So you can contrast and compare that. I used to like to put it on a clipboard or something so it's not like down here and they see. I don't think she'll like that answer. All right. So here's the difference between various questioning theoretically. This is a great one. So teamwork. How would you handle a difficult employee? That's theoretical. A leading question, are you good at handling difficult employees? Versus a behavioral question, tell me about a time you had to handle a difficult employee. And what was the result? How did you do it? Da, 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 da. Do you get the sense of what the difference is? People could be really brilliant theoretically, right? And you don't want to telegraph to them. So I just gave you that as a little reminder to kind of get that into your thought patterns. All right. Questions about this part?
Do you have a rule of thumb in terms of how many questions, how long an interview should be?
Great question. Well, in two pages, I'm going to give you a boatload of them. Basically, in our interview, you'll be hard-pressed to get more than 20 questions in. So I'm going to give you a bunch. I want you to make your own. But here's just some examples of what kinds of stuff. And so that's about, if you're going to have a 60-minute interview, which is a good amount of time, the phone screen should not be that long, no more than a half an hour. If it's going on, then it's like, why? You know, I either met my long-lost cousin or we got off track. And by the way, you want to note when you're interviewing somebody, both on the phone and in person, how many times did you have to redirect? Right? Did they go off on that tangent and you're like, I don't know where we just went, but I'm tired. Or you have them say, gee, I actually forgot the question after 5 minutes of talking, right? So get that, you know, off track, da-da-da-da-da, how to redirect. That'll give you some good information, right? Okay, so what do you want to know? Let's review. You want to know their skills. Can they do the job? You want to know their behavior. Will they do the job? And you want to know the fit. Are they going to fit into my organization? So once you know what competencies you're going for, you would design a question for each one of those, right? Yes, Debbie, that's just what I would do. That would be a good answer. So you know what you're looking for. If you're looking for somebody team-oriented, just gave you an example of, tell me about a time you were on a team, la, la, la. Their interpersonal style, tell me about conflict. How do you handle conflict? Give me about a time when you've done that. And so that's the way you're going to find the fit. And it is good. You don't want to get to a company where everybody thinks the same, right? The group think. It's like it'd be nice and easy if everyone just agreed with me. Could everyone agree with me just to make me feel good right now?
And you have a room of bobbleheads.
Yeah, bobbleheads. Everybody just give me a bobblehead. Thank you very much. But you really, you're not bringing in diversity, and you need to orbit the hairy, the hairball. Orbiting the hair, their hairball. It's a great book that we're reading in our book club at SBDC. And it's about how do you get those little outliers, because if somebody's not going to ask you questions that make, oh my God, I never thought of that. So I actually had an employee that was really good at that, because I would come up with these plans, these promotion plans. And we're going to do this, and we're going to do that, and we're going to do this. And she was the controller, and I remember going in to see her. She's a CPA, and I go, we're going to do this, we're going to do that. And she's like, that's great, and a lot of that's illegal. So payroll-wise, just little details like that, right? So you want, you know, so everyone else is like, that's great. So make sure you got somebody there that's going to give you some information if you need to do it. So I like a little diversity in the mix. Yes?
You just used a word called controller. So tell us more about controllers and where you got that word and more about other words that are related to controller or other types of people in the world, please.
Well, a controller is typically the person in charge of the financial department, comptroller, the financial manager, that type of thing. And it's really interesting you ask this question because I'm going to refer back and talk to Charlie because in reading the book about orbiting the giant hairball, they're talking about the culture. And the culture of a company that says, I want a controller. They're going to watch over the money of the organization. So if you're a creative thinker and whatnot, you may want a controller that, like she did for me, go, just a minute, let's talk about how we can make that happen in an okay way. So that's what a controller does, oftentimes an accountant background. Is that the question you had?
Yes, but I was thinking that that you're using the word based on some studying you've done that would describe other types of personality.
Oh, well, I've done that too. That would be my communication style workshop. When am I giving one of those? So some of that would be an analytical person. Great questions. That's not what I was referring to. By the way, the next job she went to, okay, she was, she didn't like the title controller and whatnot, so her title was Chief of Chocolate Bringing. Because she's into chocolate. It's the truth, right? So too funny. And she really did. She was like, she wanted that title. And she did indeed always bring chocolates, I understand. I wasn't there. So now I've got some questions for you. Here's some of my favorites, just to give you an idea, to get your juices flowing. And what I'm going to request is that now you take these home, because we're not going to have time to play with it here. And circle, Jesse, I'm going to give you a few minutes to at least circle some that you're going, oh, that's a tasty one, I'm going to want that. And start thinking about what topics that you'll know after you do your competency assessment do you want to create some questions around, right? I'm going to go through a few of these, some of my favorites. Tell me why you think you should be here. Well, if that doesn't make them nervous, I don't know what will. Tell me why you think you should be here today. Tell me what you know about our company, right, Cindy? And you're going to, but you'll already know this from the telephone screen. And I'm putting in here, so you're seeing what I'm trying to get at. And if you think about it, what do I really want to know from this person? That's the question I want to create. So if I really want to know how do they think on their feet after I just threw them a like, oh my gosh, that's a good way to do it. And I'm sure you've got jobs where people have to think on their feet, right? Or they could sit down and think. I could accommodate that. Tell me why you enjoyed most about each of your positions. And these are all, tell me, all these kinds of things. And then 7, describe what your workplace must be like for you to work at your best. Right, that's an interesting question. So these are, you know, all fit in kinds of questions. 11, I've already gone through your team when you participated on team. So if you like them, you can circle them. What was your contribution to the team? What was your role? And then you'll know how active they were in it. Were they just, you know, observing or in it or leading it? Number 14, tell me a situation where you used your best judgment and it worked in your favor or worked against you. Charles.
What are your thoughts about putting in a hypothetical if something were to happen, how would you handle it?
I like that. Yeah, hypothetical is a theoretical question. Yeah, so I would definitely, I throw some of those in hypothetically, but I just always think that hypothetically people can be give you the right answer.
Yeah.
And then, but you can always follow that up with, has that ever happened to you? So you could turn a hypothetical just into saying, tell me about a time where that happened. If they say, gee, that never happened to me, I'd say, well, how would you handle it? Please remember this. We forget this. We're having a conversation, right? They're going to talk 75% of the time, we hope. And remember, number two, we're human. So we want to have a little conversation, legal conversation, but we really want to get them engaged and get a feel for, am I going to fit in with them? Is this starting to feel comfortable or not? So that's those are good. I really like questions like 20 to 22. Tell me about how you measure your success. I want to know if they're goal-driven. Tell me about how your manager measures success. How does your company measure success? You'll see whether or not they're used to performance reviews. Not all companies do them, right? Right? So it's a really good thing. Are they used to an informal structure or a formal structure? And I can follow up. What did you like best about that? Or whatnot. Okay. Situational questions. I'm giving you a few on 23 here. This is, so these are questions I can turn into reference checks. Number 25, number 26. How do I best support you? What do you want from your supervisor? What kind of supervision works best for you? That would be helpful to know. I need constant monitoring. Well, that's just me. That's just a personal thing. And what are you looking for in your next job? It'd be interesting. And you'll know, you know, there's books out there that tell you how to answer questions, but I think some of these are pretty hard to give a canned answer to. And then there's some here for supervisors. What would you, what would you want to ask from them if they were supervisors? So now you've got all of this going on. You like some of those questions? Did you circle a couple as we went through? Okay. So if you think about I'm having an hour interview, I probably have 20 of them ready. I'd like to ask all my applicants the same question. How else can you compare? And you say, gee, I only got to 12 with this person. Does this person elaborate, go off on tangents? So you have something real to compare with this information. Then you can focus on the fit. And here's some sample questions for you. I know Sarah's wanting some of these. Tell me about the types of activities you've done on the job over the past 2 years to see if it's similar to your environment. Okay. What tasks did you enjoy? What did you not enjoy? Tell me about the best jobs you've ever had, anywhere, in any situation. Well, it was coaching a football team or something like that. Just find out. Because if you want to find out if they're a team player, have they ever played a team sport? But I don't want to ask an irrelevant question either. But that would be a way to ask that. So I actually was asked in an interview many moons ago what my favorite movie was. Now, I'm not a big supporter of these kinds of lines of questioning. I think, you know, what are they going to find out? The truth is my favorite movie is Little Shop of Horrors. And I weighed that answer very cautiously before I answered him and said, The Wizard of Oz. You know, so you know, really, what do you want to find out from me?
It wasn't a job in a barbershop, was it?
Feed me, Seymour. Not exactly. And a great, you know the ultimate answer to every question is 42. Some of you know that?
Uh-uh.
Mmm. Why do you know that? Because you've seen The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy or read the book. The ultimate answer to the question of life is 42. Now that's recorded and the rest of the world's going to know. But I've always wanted to be able to answer that to somebody, but only if I really wasn't interested in the job.
In my non-compete agreement, I put that as the address. You know, 42 anywhere town, or
Marty, I am so going to steal that. I love that. Okay, somebody knew what I was talking about. Yes, John. He's saying, get back on track, girl.
I have a real issue with some questions. I think they're silly. I'm kind of interested to hear your take. Such questions are, so, what kind of things are you really bad at? I mean, to me, that's such a ridiculous question that I've never quite understood why anybody ever asked it.
Well, I'm really bad at answering silly questions. I think that might end an interview, though. But yeah, I'm not into those kinds of questions about, you know, your favorite movie and that type of thing.
What are strengths and weaknesses? What, you know, what would you consider?
Yeah, that's very traditional. Is you know, what? But people practice that, Marty.
If somebody asks me, what are my weaknesses? Am I going to tell them? I'm going to say no, I haven't.
Oh no, I've had people actually tell me. And again, as a career, I have a private business, and for 10 years I've been doing career coaching, outplacement programs, that kind of stuff, which has nothing to do with my business advising here. So, you know, I'm on the other side helping people, and you can get a book, you can get online, and here's the right answer to that, right? All I want to know is I want to get to know the person authentically. So instead of that, I'd like to ask, you know, what skills do you think would be most useful here? What areas do you think you'll need some development and help with? So I like to kind of round that out a little bit. They'll be ready with that. Well, I'm very, you know, they'll give me their pat answer. And I don't want that. I want to know what their issues are going to pertain to me and my job. So, yeah, I mean, it's the traditional question. It's not a bad question. I just think you can make it better. All right. Good. All right, so that's where I'm at, building the atmosphere. I like to tell people ahead of time because the kind of interview you're going to run is a little different than they've probably experienced before. I like to tell them what to expect. We're going to spend about 45 minutes together. I'm going to ask you some questions that are going to be based on your past experiences, right? I'm going to take notes. I like to tell them I'm going to take notes. So it'll help me remember. And it kind of calms people down. People are a little nervous sometimes in interviews, right? So I just like to let them know what to expect. I like to offer them water. There is this one place that did an interview, not for me, but it's just anecdotal information. They put one bottle of water, like I've done here, over there. They all had water, and they had one bottle of water there. And it was one of their screening techniques to see if the person actually had the audacity to go get it. Really? I kid you not, right? Yeah, you know, did they get it? Did they leave it? Did they ask for it? Well, I think that's somewhere that would be not interesting. I think it was rude. Personally, so I would just say offer them water or something, you know. Offer them water. Don't drink in front of them, you know, just eat your pizza in front of them. So that's what I mean by this, is explain what you're going to do. You're going to do note-taking. Try to pace it. And I like to tell them ahead of time is that we have a limited amount of time together. And if, in fairness to all, to both of us, if I feel we're getting off track, please understand I'm going to redirect and bring you back, right? And then it's just like, okay, hang in there, Cindy, stop. You know, I can then now politely say, thank you, all set on that. I'd like to ask another question. I would just bring her back to it. Because you have been through that, haven't you? When you're going, my laundry list I've got, my, you know, and it's like, okay. So that's not going to help you. Okay. So then when you close the interview, that's when you're going to compare your notes. Please try to have your interviews in fairly rapid succession. This one, I'm going to do one this week and one next week and whatnot. How are you going to really remember? Please, please, if you have an open position and it's impacting your productivity, it is, in my view, one of the very most, if not the most important thing you can do for your company. So yeah, I know you're making it and you're packing it and everything like that, but if you need help focus on it, get it done. You're going to lose candidates. I actually have had clients, unbelievably, not be contacted after applying for 5 months. Yay. All right, so the best candidates are gone, right? Or many. It's like, what are you thinking? You know, when you do it, make it a priority, get it done, interview, boom, boom, boom. What do you think on that, Charlie? He's raising his hand. It's not that I just randomly go, give me an answer back there, guys.
Well, having had managers work under me a long time, one of the things when we used to teach them how to interview, the hardest thing for the interviewer is to shut up and listen. You don't need to tell, or if they say something that you agree with, you don't need to jump in and start doing the interview for them. So we used, because it's amazing how, if you think about it, you're chatting with somebody across the desk or whatever, and you kind of go through the whole thing, and you ask them a question, and all of a sudden they give you something that registers with you as a positive, and all of a sudden you start speaking and telling them how good that was, how you did it, what you would do, and it's, that's what it's not all about. So you have to learn to zip it, listen, listen, and listen.
Yeah, boy, that's great. Absolutely right on that. And I think I skipped a page. But you reminded me of something really important and about listen, listen, listen. And I don't know what it was, but that was good. I would, okay. I know what it was, but I'm not going to tell you now. See, that made you think I didn't actually forget it. No, I forgot it, but I thought, I'll just tell you later, obviously. Oh, my goodness. It didn't work, did it? But because I told you, I confess. All right, it'll come back to me or not. So then when you're making your final decisions, please notify the people that did not get hired. Please let them know by email or something like that so they're not just the hanging participles of your life, that they actually know. Yes, Gail.
Well, is it appropriate that if you've just got applications that you don't respond to those, that you only respond to the people that interviewed?
Well, my personal feelings about it is that every one of those is an opportunity for goodwill. So when they sent in the resume application, it's a great opportunity. Thank you for applying. This is what our process is going to be. We'll be reviewing now, and the people deemed most qualified will be called in for an interview. If not, thank you for your interest in our organization. Your file will be your information will be kept on file for a year, which you need to do, and thank you. It's going to save you the 20 phone calls, you know, saying, did you receive my application, and what are you doing with it? But, you know, think of yourself on the other end of the deal. Somebody took potentially hours to apply to your job, right?
Well, the caveat I have is that sometimes, like what you said, I get a dozen of these Craigslist, and they have nothing to do or very little to do with what the job description. So my, if it's...
So I would just give them that pat, you know, little response, thank you for applying. If you're deemed, you know, qualified, I would do that. And then I would leave it at that, because then you're not promising you're going to contact them. But if you brought them in for an interview and they invested time and energy, then of course you're going to do that. Yeah. So, yeah, I really think it's one of those nice impressions when you do something like that. And it's hard for people applying for jobs that are really looking. All right. So now here we are. I'm going to notify your candidates right away. I don't notify my second choice until my first choice has gotten confirmed and my reference checks are complete, right? Okay. So you don't do that. And then you just outline the next steps. Yeah.
Can you just clarify what you have for definition of benefits versus features?
Oh, yeah. What page am I?
Well,
are you?
26.
Yeah, thank you, because I've skipped a little bit because I'm getting my motor going. Okay, where are you? I mean, I'll just tell you what I mean by that. We offer health insurance. The benefit of that is we cover, you know, we offer that to your family or whatnot, and we subsidize that. We pay a certain amount. You get lunch. we give you this, we get 25%, you know, so, and you get employee discounts versus that means that 25% discounts and stuff, and so that allows you to, you know, enjoy our products at a reasonable cost, that type of thing. So the feature is the thing. What do you get from it? So you think about what your features are, and then it's the so what. So if somebody's going, okay, everybody says that, the so what is what you're going to get from it. Why is that a benefit to them? Okay, good thing. So about, I want to get into reference checking because I know that that'll spark some interest. I talked a little bit about it in the beginning, right, about how to sidestep people like I used to be, an HR manager. Right, Gail, you're appreciating this help. How to sidestep it. Do you instruct your employees not to give references?
Yeah,
you do. So that's why. They're going to do. So here's some reference checking questions that you can ask. Gail, tell me, are there any of these? Would you only give name, rank, and serial number for former employees in general? I'm putting her on the spot. I'm just curious.
I'm rewriting the handbook, and that's what it says in the handbook.
Yeah, yeah. The important thing really is if somebody's good and you give them a reference check and someone was not so successful with you and you don't give them a reference check, you're building a situation for yourself, right? Because you're kind of telegraphing, well, I'm not going to give a reference check on this one. That's a problem. Be consistent in what you do, right? But if someone does do an in-run and you want to try to talk to their other references, their coworkers or whatnot, here's some questions that you can ask them. Their former supervisors, these are good things to do. And this is what I would, here's where I would try to get this information. Am I always successful? No. So I'm going to tell you another question I'd like you to ask your applicants. Okay? Tell me what your former supervisor is going to tell me when I call for a reference. They might tell you some really interesting thing. Well, they'd say everything get along, right? So I'm going to ask my applicant that. How would you rank yourself on a scale of 1 to 10, with 10 being I'm the best employee they ever had, right? Where would you rank yourself on a scale of 1 to 10 with your former? Where do you think your boss, your former boss, would rank you?
Does the reference check come before or after the second interview?
I do it after the second interview. So I might interview 5 or 6 people, narrow it down. I want to then do my reference checks and make my decision at that time. Yeah. There's some places that do a conditional offer employment pending the results of a successful reference check, but I just do it, making that a presumptive condition.
Well, I often find that references, they take a long time to call back sometimes, so I used to do it that way, but now I try to do it a little bit more upfront, just give people on vacations. And if the reference is not coming back, I could ask the employee, well,
could you intervene? Yep.
Yeah,
that's all you know. That's all well and good as long as you have it signed off and whatnot. When there's companies that ask for send me your references ahead of time along with the application, I'm really uncomfortable with that.
If I had a company that I worked for with specific skills, but I haven't done it for several years, if I had a job reference from that person, that's not a good thing.
Could you help me out? I'm not sure I heard it all.
Like if I go into an interview for a specific position, mm-hmm. if I have a referral from the boss with me, is that a good thing or bad?
Oh, thank you for asking that question. I gave her a tip for that. Thank you. If they come in with a written reference letter, you're going to confirm it. You're going to verify it. Does anybody have, if you have letterhead, does your employees potentially have access to your letterhead? Okay, so you're going to confirm any glowing or any letters of recommendation. So that's fine. You can take that as a as part of the reference checking policy, and it's great to have that.
I just wanted to share an experience I had which drew me, and that was so one person came in and they had pre-written reference letters, and as I read them, I started to see a pattern and suspected that they wrote them themselves because the language they used was very similar. And also, this position required a certain degree, a certain license, and found out that they got their advanced degree through a diploma mill, which I had, it just some things, the flags were there, and I said, I gotta check this. I mean, they brought me their diploma from this such-and-such university, and I went online and saw that I called them. It was a diploma mill.
All right, so you're going to confirm, especially, you're dealing with RNs and LPNs probably, so it's all good. So you'll just confirm it. Thank you for asking that question. I was forgetting to go there. So here's reference check questions. Get it, see what you can do to be as successful. But if you really ask the applicant, here's what I'm going to ask on a reference. What do you think they're going to have to say? You can kind of, you read the body language and the profuse sweating. you can get a clue, right? I actually have asked people, where would you rate yourself? And they rated themselves in every category a 10. And it's like, you ain't Bo Derek. What do you think? What are you thinking here? You're not, is anybody really a 10? And that did that not give me some important information? It's all about them, right? So I thought that was interesting. I would never rate myself as an expert in anything. I always think there's something more to learn, and I don't think I'm a 10 in anything. Well, of course. but, in general, not so much. So that's what I have to say about hiring right the first time. And I want to just give you a couple of minutes for Q&A, if you haven't already gotten me on that. I'm going to turn it back over so we can finish off with the evals and that type of stuff. So Q&A, Nicole.
I'm not really understanding why an HR professional would not want to give a reference.
It's so many legal concerns these days. Yeah, it's liability that somebody is saying, I didn't get the job because Nicole said this, or it's the old-fashioned term of blackballing, and Nicole didn't know me so well. And really, the HR department, how many people does the HR person actually supervise and actually know the person? It's not even the most effective person to speak to get a reference, unless they were in the HR department.
So in the case of Gail's place currently, if I were to call the actual supervisor of this employee, I would be told, no, you have to speak with Gail. But then Gail doesn't actually know the person, and the policy is to not.
And that person's been instructed to give dates. Actually, they've been instructed to speak to HR.
What I do is I ask people to provide me the consent to release information that they're asking for me for a reference, and that also helps to relieve me as the reference provider of liability.
Okay.
See what I'm saying? So they're saying it's okay to check it, and I want a copy of that saying that they've acknowledged that.
Okay.
So that's our practices.
So what you're saying is if an employee leaves, you're asking them?
No. Not if an employee leaves, but if someone calls, says, hey, so-and-so used to work here, I say, well, send me an acknowledgement form that they've acknowledged that it's okay to check their references.
Thank you. That's really good information. So say, sure, send me, send that. But I do that even if it was just name, rank, and serial number. Do you provide more information than that? I'm just curious. Thank you. I appreciate companies that do. There really isn't that much liability unless you're going to give only negative references.
Company gives up by not providing references, all so risk liability trade-off is, but frankly, the municipal world is a small world.
Mm-hmm.
I want my employees to know that you want to do good work for me and be responsive and not burn your bridge on the way out, because what the most valuable thing you have if you want to move up, move out, is a reference.
Yes.
And so
That's right.
All that you've worked for.
And Gail, tell me this, a quick question. If I call and you say name, rank, and serial number, and I also say, and is this person eligible for rehire with your company?
That's what I was going to say.
I knew that. That's why I asked.
The question, would you rehire this individual?
And you would answer that. Are they
yes or no, but then that could be really
that's
not a very fair way of handling it, unless you give them information.
But you're saying that, yes. There's nothing bad there. That yes, you would. The company would recommend
this. I will say though, I was, part of what I'm hiring, I'm not just looking to add value to the organization. I'm looking to reduce risk. And people are going to give me canned references. This signals, why didn't you give me your previous boss as a reference? Sometimes there's reasons. You can ask Suzanne and Dan about that.
This is my
why
boss.
That might not. I'm kind of loaded up the room here. But, I will say, though, everything's a risk trade-off, but I was curious because she said, and I'll wait for the right time once I have a consent release information form, but I will check people that are not on their reference list. If I know someone that knows this person that I have confidence in a work context, I had someone that just applied for a job and said, I did work for so-and-so, since I have left, and I want to know, out of an interview type of situation, what was that person's interface? Did they do good work or didn't they? That's all part of,
and
that's okay, but you seem to be hesitant to place those calls, and that to me are often the most valuable things. Not are you telling me, but if someone doesn't give me their boss and I know who their boss is, I'm always going to call their boss, but I'm sure going to call their boss if they didn't put it as a reference.
Well, I'll rephrase.
Yeah.
The rephrasing, I haven't seen your release form that says, to make inquiries into my character. And you have, I know the town will have an attorney.
Right.
And if they've reviewed it and say, you're good to go, then you're good to go. But if you're, if you don't have a release form, I'm just going to really want it to be able to say that that I'm giving you permission to make inquiries into my character. Again, thinking about if you're buying a house, would you want the bank going around to your neighbors and saying, do they mow their lawn well and stuff like that?
Well, I'm not asking personal questions. I'm asking, so this case, the person said they were an engineer for a wastewater treatment expansion. So I've actually had people put, hey, I did so and such work for a town I used to work for, and I don't think so. I was the town manager.
Oh.
So the first thing is I'm checking.
That's great.
Did they want? Trying to find out, is this person telling me the truth? So first thing I'm looking to confirm is, did they actually do that?
Well, then, Charles, that's perfect. Yeah. Then you're just going to say, okay, you did that. Let me know who you reported to.
Well, I'm not asking about the baseball or football. Did they work for you? And did they do quality work? Did they show up on time? Is that in your mind within the realm?
No, I think what you want to do is what you're doing. But when they say, I've done that, say, and I need a contact person there. And that will be, understand, that will be part of your release. I just want informed consent. I'm cautious. John, he's given me 4 minutes. Okay, I just thought he was giving me bunny ears. He's going to give me bunny ears really soon. So, okay, last question. Does it belong to you? What do you think? I think it might.
The question?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm wondering about interviews that come from out of state, or potential applicants from out of state who are interested in relocating, and how you would make a person from coming up for an interview.
And not very many companies do that anymore.
They don't.
So you might. Here's some ways where I've seen it handled before. Dartmouth College pays everything. Come, enjoy, Hanover Inn, it's great. Some do, but realistically it might be, and I will give you this much towards it, or I will reimburse you upon an offer of employment. So, I might do something like that, or, whatever you can financially handle. But generally it's the job seeker's responsibility to bear the brunt of that, and believe me, there are fewer and fewer and fewer companies covering those expenses. Wish they didn't, but if you can afford it, no one would object.
I was just going to share, we're seeing that more and more now with
Skype. Interview through Skype or WebEx.
Those are great ways of doing it.
So, and we've hired someone with that who's.
I've got bunny ears. I've been given bunny ears. I'll talk to you afterwards. I want to turn it back over to John, because if I don't, he's bigger than me and it might hurt. Okay. Hey, you know, I've had a lot of fun. Thanks for coming and playing with me for a few hours. And good luck.
We're looking forward to your job description on the fall.
Okay. I love that one. Thank you. Hey, right back at you. This has been my favorite group yet. You're doing good, John. I thought so.
Okay, a few things. You all should have an evaluation form to fill out. Please fill that out and hand it to Charlie on your way out the door. It's very important to us to know most of the answers. Also, we do these workshops 8 times a year, and we're always looking for new topics to cover. If you have a particular topic you'd like to see us do a workshop on, please write on the back of that form. That will help us in putting together our list for next year. We're all set for this year. There are 2 events coming up that I want to let you know about. First of all, our next workshop in April, which is April 15th, I believe, which is the third Wednesday of the month, and it's going to be on time management, a very important topic for all of us. I think one of the things to think about when you're looking at time management, if you are a manager or an owner of a business or you're running a department or whatever it is, it's very important to be able to make time to be able to work on your business and not in your business. If you don't do that, you are really leaving yourself short. If you find yourself all the time saying, I can't go to that workshop, I haven't got the time. I can't work on my business plan, I haven't got the time. I can't write that press release, I haven't got the time. You need to take this workshop on time management, believe it. The woman doing it is Carrie Gendro. She's done workshops for us before. She is just as good as Deb, I assure you. She's out of Littleton. She's done workshops for us before. One was on the 7 secrets of first-class customer service.
Awesome.
One was on the 5 secrets of successful negotiations. She's really good at what she does. So I encourage you to keep your eyes open and come to that shop. We also, on April 7th, we'll be doing the 2nd annual Memorial County Business and Financial Assistance Forum. It will be right here on the 7th. There will be 12 presenters from various agencies, both federal and state, who will be talking about what their agencies have to offer in terms of assistance to small business, how they operate, what the eligibility requirements are, et cetera, et cetera. That particular forum is free. But you do need to sign up for it. And I've already started the promotion on that. It's been on Front Porch Forum once. It'll be out there again in about 2 weeks. And it'll be in the paper, all that stuff. You'll also be getting emails about it if you are in the SBDC database, which you are, and then you have now attended this workshop.
So are both of these here?
Yes. Okay. Our workshops are always right here in the room. If you, on the way out, if you like, there's a bunch of these brochures on the table. It's a, do you need business assistance? This is a brochure I put together about a year ago, which is kind of a pocket guide to all sorts of sources of business assistance in this region. And so please pick it up, and thanks for coming.
Thank you.